Hello everyone! In this video, I will show you the Zero Trust Access in the Cisco Secure Firewall Threat Defense. I am Chris Grabowski, Technical Marketing Engineer with Cisco. Starting from 7.4 release of Threat Defense software, you can provide a Zero Trust Clientless Access. Now your users on the internet or campus network can use a browser to securely access web applications behind the firewall. The Zero Trust Access followed the ZTNA principles, providing access with strong multi-factor user authentication, granting the per-application list privilege access, and evaluating the posture of the endpoint. On top of that, the client-to-application traffic is fully decrypted and subjected to intrusion and malware protections, at the same time providing a seamless user experience with streamlined SAML authentication flow and single sign-on. Let's have a look how this works. Once your client types in the URL of the application in the browser, the request is directed by DNS resolution to the firewall's interface. The firewall redirects the user to SAML identity provider for authentication and authorization. The SAML provider requests user credentials and may impose multi-factor authentication and perform posture assessment. Upon success, the client redirects back to the firewall with a message holding the SAML assertion. The firewall verifies SAML response provided by the client and, if accepted, responds with a ZTA cookie, which allows client to access the protected application. The firewall decrypts client packets and protects your internal application with Snort Engine. Now let's see how to configure the Zero Trust Access in your firewall. Here we are in the Firewall Management Center, running 7.4 release of software. You can find the clientless ZTA under Policies and Zero Trust Application. Let me add a new ZTA policy and walk you through the configuration process. In this initial setup page, you configure the global settings of your ZTA policy. At the top of the page, you can see a nice reference diagram with key elements of the ZTA setup. There is a user on the internet authenticating to a SAML identity provider, a private application behind the firewall, the inside and outside security zones, as well as the identity certificate. As we move on with the setup, you will see how these elements make up the Zero Trust application policy. Let's start with a name of the policy and some description. The domain name you configure in the next step is required by the firewall to construct an URL used by the clients during the SAML authentication flow. Whenever you configure an URL in ZTA setup, you need to ensure the DNS is configured to resolve to a correct element of the solution. In this case, the domain name must resolve to the IP address of the firewall's interface closest to the end user. In my lab setup, I use ZTNA emealab.local domain name, which I already pre-configured on the DNS server. Let me switch over to the firewall console and my test PC to confirm if this domain name resolves correctly. My firewall has four interfaces configured, and in this example, I'll use the internet-facing interface as the ZTA outside. On my client PC, I'll ping the ZTNA emealab.local domain, and you will see it correctly resolves to the IP address of my firewall. The next important configuration element is the firewall's identity certificate. This is a certificate that represents all your protected applications during the Zero Trust authentication. The firewall performs full TLS decryption of the client session and therefore must present a certificate that is trusted by the client and valid for any ZTNA application. The easiest solution is to use a certificate with a wildcard entry in the subject alternative name, as in my example here. Next, we specify the client-side security zones. This setting tells the firewall which interfaces accept ZTA clientless connections. In my example, I select the internet zone associated with the outside interface. The ZTA is not limited to internet clients, though. You could equally well use ZTA to secure application access from the internal network. Next, you configure the pool of high TCP ports that are used for the client to application connections after successful authentication and authorization. I'll just leave the defaults here. Lastly, you configure the intrusion and malware protection policies applied to Zero Trust client flows. You can override these policies on individual applications and application groups later in the ZTA configuration. Now, with global settings complete, we can proceed to configuring application access. Here you have two configuration options: an application group or an individual application. The application groups allow you to club multiple apps together, providing single sign-on and protection settings. For example, if you configure three applications in a group, the clientless user has to authenticate once to any of the apps to get access to the whole group. If you prefer more granular control, you can configure the applications individually. In such case, for each protected application, you may set specific SAML IDP, ingress interface, and IPS malware protections. For the purpose of this demonstration, I'll set up a single application. My protected application is the admin UI of a standalone dynamic attributes connector instance. Next, we set the external URL, which will be used by the clients to access the protected application. You need to ensure that the DNS on the client side resolves this external URL to the IP address of the firewall interface closest to the client. In the next field, you may configure an application URL, which tells the firewall how to reach the application on the inside. The DNS used by the firewall needs to resolve this application URL to the real IP address of the protected application server. You have an option to configure the same external and application URLs, or by deselecting this option here, you can set them to be different. In this demonstration, I use the same URL on both sides, ensuring correct DNS resolution setup. I'll switch now to the firewall CLI and the PC again to show you an example of a proper DNS configuration. On the endpoint, if I ping the external URL, the DNS should resolve to the IP address of the firewall's outside interface. If you think about it, it really makes sense. When the user types in the protected application URL in the browser, the request goes directly to the firewall outside interface. From there on, the firewall takes control over the Zero Trust authentication and authorization process. If I run the same test on the firewall, you'll notice the DNS resolves to the real IP address of the CSDAC server inside the protected network. This is also logical, as the firewall needs to understand the real IP address of the application to forward clients' packets from the outside interface to the correct server on the inside. Next, we need to provide the certificate of the application along with the private key. In the ZTA flow, the firewall performs full TLS decryption using the known key method. If you ever configured a decryption policy on firewall before, you might be familiar with the known key decryption, used when decrypting traffic to local servers with their private keys. In this example, I already have a certificate and the private key of the CSDAC application in my FMC, and I will just select it from the drop-down menu. If we configured a group before, we could now make this application part of it. In such case, most of the upcoming configuration in this wizard would be skipped and inherited from the group level settings. In the second step, the firewall provides its SAML integration details. The entity ID you see here lets the SAML identity provider understand what application the client is trying to access. The assertion consumer service is the URL steering the client back to the firewall after the SAML's successful authentication and authorization. When doing the configuration, you'll take the firewall's entity ID and the ACS URL to your SAML provider, and in return you get SAML IDP's metadata, describing to the firewall how to reach and authenticate with the provider. The entity ID uniquely defines your SAML identity provider. Single sign-on URL is the address of the SAML provider where the firewalls redirects the clients to perform authentication. And the IDP certificate is used to verify the signature of the SAML authentication responses. Next, you specify how often the user needs to re-authenticate to the firewall when accessing this application. By default, it's set to 1 day. Lastly, you can set the client-facing security zone and the IPS and malware protection policies for that particular application. In our example, I'll just leave inherited settings that I configured earlier in the global setup. We can now proceed to the summary of the configuration and review if everything is set as expected. Now we can see the application is configured. You can check the URLs, SAML details, protection policies, and if this application access is enabled. The last step is to associate this policy with a firewall and deploy the configuration. The Zero Trust Access policies are assigned to individual firewall devices. Therefore, each firewall may have a different ZTA policy assigned if needed. The policy is now active and we can give it a test drive. Here we can see the desktop of a PC connected to the laboratory network. The user opens a browser and types in the URL of the application. This is the external URL we configured in the application setup. This request hits the firewall, which in turn redirects the client to the SAML identity provider. The user enters the credentials, and if successful, the second factor authentication kicks in. The user is redirected back to the firewall and allowed through to the protected application. If you look at the address bar, you'll notice that this connection goes through a high TCP port from the pool we configured in the global ZTA policy settings. The experience of the user is really seamless. He can now get access to the protected application and use it as if it was locally available.